Good evening. This is the Planning Board meeting, Newmarket, New Hampshire, May 18th, 2010. Please join us in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Looking at the audience, it seems futile, but we'll open the meeting for public comments this time at 7:01. Seeing none, we'll close the public comment period at 7:01 and 15 seconds. We have minutes to approve, the minutes of the 13th of April meeting. Everyone, I'm sure, has looked at those minutes. Are there any changes, amendments, deletions?
Justin, I don't think, was at the April 13th meeting. I hate to be the bearer of bad
news. I just felt so badly about
We wanted you here.
Him, but we wanted to make sure you knew you were included.
Two before that I was left off, but I was there. Okay.
Before we go further into the meetings, George Willen is not here, so Adam is going to sit in for George as an alternate, and Janice Rose is not here, so Justin's going to sit in for Janice. And Eric is not here because he resigned, so Rick, you're on, so now we've taken care of that, correct?
I think you need to vote on replacing Eric.
Well, we will. We'll get to that. We're just doing the minutes right now.
Who's Adam sitting in for?
George.
For George.
George,
Janice, and Eric. So, the minutes.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
Page 9, I think it was meant to be said on line 6, did not see this process as slowing down rather than slowed down. That's all I got.
Thank you.
Rick?
Can I just ask a question on page 3, line 19, new market, two words, is that?
It is correct.
Okay.
New market credit builder. To be confused
market.
With the town of
Newmarket.
Anything else? Seeing no other corrections, deletions, or additions, I'll call for a motion.
Make a motion to accept the minutes as amended.
Seconded.
Seconds. Moved and seconded. Any discussion? Seeing none, I'll call for a vote. All those in favor of approving the minutes as amended, please indicate by saying aye.
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 Opposed? It's unanimous.
Abstain.
Abstain. I'm sorry. One abstention. Sorry about that. Next, we had a resignation. Eric Weston resigned from the Planning Board. And RSA 673:12 allows us to, by appointment of the planning Board members, until the next regular municipal election, at which time a successor shall be elected to either fill the unexpired term or start a new term as appropriate. So we need to replace Eric Weston for the next basically 12 months. Is there a nomination? Eric.
I'd like to make a motion to appoint Rick McManaman to fill Eric Weston's term.
Second.
Rick has been nominated and seconded. Are there any other nominations? Seeing none, I'll close the nomination period. Any discussion? Seeing none, I'll call for a vote. All those in favor of Rick McManaman as the replacement for Eric Weston until May election of next year, please indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstentions? Congratulations.
Thank you all very, very much. Appreciate it.
Next, we have the interesting responsibility to elect a chairman and a vice chairman. So I will open the floor for nominations for chairman. Val?
Make a motion to nominate John Badger for chairman for the ensuing year.
Second.
Okay. Any other nominations? Okay, it's moved and seconded. I'll call.
Do you want to go for another year?
Do I want to? I had tried not to. I had hoped that someone else would, as some members know, I had hoped that someone else would step up and do it. But for a variety of reasons, that didn't work.
I have a question about the absence of George Willett, who has served as chairman in the past, and I realize we haven't had a chance to talk to George about it. Is there a possibility that this responsibility, since it's not something that you're looking to take on, it could be passed on at a future meeting when he is here to accept the role?
I think Diane had a conversation with George, did she not? And his answer was?
He doesn't have the time to do it.
Okay. Question asked and answered. Thank you.
I'll call for a vote. If there are no other nominations, call for a vote. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 I'll abstain. Thank you very much, I guess. All right.
Thank you. Thank you for agreeing to serve, John.
Standing ovation.
I'll open nominations for vice chairman. Rick?
Nominate Peter Roy as vice chairman.
Second.
Thank you.
Are there any other nominations? Seeing none, I'll call for a vote. All those in favor of Peter Roy as vice chairman, indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? And congratulations.
Thank you so much, Mr. Badger.
Hard-fought battle. Now, we have one other housekeeping duty. We have Adam Schrader, who is, his appointment is up, and he has gratefully and most appreciatively volunteered to do another three-year term. And I would like ask for a nomination for to have Adam to serve again as an alternate.
Nomination for Adam Schroeder to appear as an alternate for the next 3 years.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Are there any other nominations? Any discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor, please indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? Abstentions? Thank you very much, Adam. Next on the agenda is a public hearing to amend Title III, Land Use Code and Regulations, Chapter 4, Zoning Ordinance, in accordance with RSA 675:2 and 675:7. The purpose of these amendments is to bring Newmarket's Shoreland Protection Regulations into compliance with the State Comprehensive Shoreline Protection Act, as set forth in RSA 483B. I would like to also recognize that Eric, Janice, Val, and Diane worked as a committee on this, and what we have now before us is their recommendations. And Diane, do you want to lead us through this?
Certainly, may. I'd also like to recognize Cynthia Copeland, helped us with the process, and appreciate her input and feedback and guidance throughout the process as well, and she attended all of the subcommittee meetings. Thank you, Cynthia. As we've discussed at previous meetings, back in 2008, the state shoreline protection state law was completely revamped, and there were many changes which in effect brought our local ordinance out of sync, if you will, with the state law. And the subcommittee was set up primarily to bring our local ordinance into compliance with the changes. The changes that were made in 2008 were involved things such as restrictions on the amount of impervious surfaces within the protected shoreline, which is an area measured from the mean high water line, and it's a distance of 250 feet. There are also restrictions that were placed on forestry management, and the previous system was replaced with a point system for the maintenance of woodland buffers. Also, the biggest part of it is the setback requirement. The minimum requirement under the State Comprehensive Shoreland Protection Act is 50 feet. However, Newmarket has had a more stringent requirement, a setback of 125 feet. The ordinance that is before you is the result of several meetings that were held by the subcommittee, and basically it brings our ordinance into compliance. It recognizes Newmarket's desire to have a more stringent setback requirement, and it also addresses certain provisions of the state law that the town of Newmarket would like to continue to see enforced within an area referred to as the urban exemption zone. And if you recall, a year or so ago, we defined an area on our map, and there's a map up here at the front that shows that area. It's basically the urbanized area that these maps in here. It's the urbanized area in the downtown district, which under the state law is now exempt. However, we wanted to reinstate certain provisions, and that includes the property on the other side of Bryant Rock, over the bridge, including the mill yard, and goes down as far as Creighton Street, and the town always wanted to reclaim the property. The recommendation of the committee is that certain requirements pertaining to fertilizer use, salt storage facilities, hazardous waste, junkyards, erosion control, and the restrictions on chemicals that are used for fertilizer use would still be applicable to that area. And in the draft ordinance that you see before you, that section is addressed in paragraph 5.02, subparagraph D, subparagraph 1. There was also a provision that for accessory structures, that the setback requirement would be consistent with the state, which would be 20 feet from the reference line, whereas the primary setback would be 125 feet. And in paragraph E, we list all the parcels that are exempt that I showed you earlier on the map, and we tie in the definitions back into the state law. So what we have is basically here is what the state requirements are and what the state definitions are. And Cynthia, would you like to add anything additional?
No, I think that covers
it. Does that give an overview? Okay, and I know Valerie has reviewed this with the Conservation Commission at their last meeting, and she had some suggested changes for revisions to this draft. And Valerie, I guess I'll turn it over to you so you can review those with the board.
The comments from the Conservation Commission that they want the Planning Board to consider as an amendment to the proposed ordinance would be under Section C, the overlay district boundary, simply changing the beginning of the second sentence to read the applicable water bodies, just to make that clear to the public. And then under Section D1 regarding the exempted area, I'll read the last sentence, the last line of page one. That should read, New Hampshire Department of Environmental Services, the following minimum standards as set forth in RSA 483B9 shall apply. Section 2, as Diane has it, salt storage yards, automobile junkyard, solid or hazardous waste facilities, and Roman numeral 2, and D, fertilizer application. And then the commission, then the commission wants added Roman numeral 5, A2, capital A, chemicals, and then Roman numeral 5, D, erosion and siltation. So that we'd be adding those two components regarding chemical use within the buffer and erosion and siltation controls. Also adding those minimum standards even to the exempt areas.
When you say erosion controls, what?
So if work is being done within the buffer under section 5 of the ordinance, is that they have to manage stormwater and conduct erosion and sediment controls during and after construction. So even if you're downtown and you're, let's say, working on the mill project, that those types of erosion control mechanisms need to be in place.
Okay. Could you, for me, explain a little bit more, clarify fertilizer applications?
Mm-hmm. The fertilizer application, well, the ones that the commission wants added, the chemical applications, which includes the pesticides and herbicides.
This is within 250 feet?
Actually, that section, I believe, is in the buffer, which is 250 feet, that section. Within the waterfront buffer, the buffer is within 50 feet of the reference line, and within the waterfront buffer, the following prohibitions and limitations shall apply. And again, this is so that the exempt areas are not exempt from this section. No chemicals shall be applied, including pesticides or herbicides of any kind, except as allowed under special permit issued by the Division of Pesticide Controls, under rules adopted by the Pesticide Control Board, under RSA 541A, or fertilizers of any kind, except those specified in RSA 483B92D, which we've already have included, which is the use of lime and slow-release nitrogen.
And so that's within 50 feet?
Within 50 feet is that section. It just didn't make sense to the commission that we would still allow those types of uses next to the Lamprey River, which is discharging into Great Bay.
Well, yeah, I was thinking it might be more than 50 feet, that's all.
No, that's, and that
it's
applies
just
to
the exempted area.
Right.
The urban area.
I'm
and,
good.
And the 50 and the other feet areas, applies every, is in all areas.
Right.
The 50-foot waterfront buffer for the use of herbicides and other chemicals.
Okay. Are there any questions? Any problems with the amendments that Val has suggested?
Is it a motion?
Yes, we're looking for a motion now.
I'll make a motion to approve the amendment of Section 502 Shoreline Protection Overlay District as presented, and with the amendment and the changes suggested by the Conservation Commission as presented tonight.
Second.
It's moved and seconded. Any further discussion? Seeing none, I'll call for a vote. All those in favor, please indicate by saying aye.
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 Opposed? Abstentions? Okay, there you are.
Okay. Now, this is a zoning change. So it will be sent to the town council with a recommendation, and we will talk to the chairman to see if we can get that on the
agenda. We know somebody here, I think.
and we will present it to the town council at your next workshop or meeting that you feel like to have. Yeah.
We'll get it on the agenda.
Yep. Okay.
Okay. Good.
Thank you.
Thank you. Next is old business, new business, and I have some notes here. First, I thought, with the indulgence of the planning board, Diane, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think this is the time where we reappoint representatives to various boards and commissions. And maybe in doing so, the present representative, if they happen to be here, might give us an update or a report. So the first one I have noted down here is the Conservation Commission, and that's Val. And I don't know if there's anything you want to share with us on the Conservation Commission and...
Well, we'll have it under the new items on the designated river. Are we just going to speak about that?
Yeah.
Okay. No, the commission, we're, I think what I would like to report is we're happy to have a full board now. We've got a few new members that have just joined, so we have full board relative to appointed, you know, members and alternates. We've got a lot of talent on that board, a lot of people with environmental and engineering backgrounds. So I think we have a well-rounded board there now. Very involved, the commission's very involved with the upkeep of the parks, creation of trails for a lot of the open space land. As the planning board's probably aware, the open space commission was merged in with the Conservation Commission. I think that helped us get new members. Drew Keyfavor has been elected our chairman for this coming year. And again, they're just, you know, the boards are just, the commission's very active and just, and there he is. And just maintaining our open space lands in the public conservation areas of the town. If anyone has any questions or anything they want me to bring to the commission, I would like to stay on as the representative.
Would you be willing to do that?
We'd definitely be willing to.
Any problems? Great. Thank you very much. Next is the CIP. Peter?
Yeah, there is nothing to report other than the fact that we're very anxious to get an early start, as we have been for the last 3 years. But unfortunately, we don't always get a start as early as we'd like to. We're hoping for all kinds of cooperation from the various departments, and we'll probably get started, I would say, hopefully in July. So, and I would be willing to continue in that role if you would like me to.
Terrific. Any problems with Peter continuing there? No. Great. Thank you very much, Peter. The next on the on my list is a Black Bear TIF. I've been the representative of Black Bear TIF. The latest on that is that, as you know, that the town reached an agreement with Mark Stevens, who is a developer and landholder on the other side of the railroad tracks in Black Bear, to build a railroad crossing. And he is progressing with his work, supported by an ad hoc committee made up of Steve Minatelli, Eric Botterman, and me. And right now, Mr. Stevens is preparing an application to be made with the what was formerly known as the Boston and Maine Railroad, now I guess it's the Pan Am Railroad. There were discussions with the Department of Transportation, the commissioner, Mr. Campbell, and he recommended to go ahead and file the application with the railroad, and that's what's being developed at this point. So I think, Eric, correct me if I'm wrong, but tomorrow night you will consider a new representative to Black Bear TIF and I guess another other committees.
Yes. Excuse me, yes.
Okay.
I believe there's
one term up for the Black Bear TIF, and tomorrow night there'll be a vote on a reappointment.
And I would expect that after that person is reappointed, whoever that is, then there'll be a meeting. But that's the latest from the Black Bear TIF. And the ad hoc rail crossing committee. Advisory Heritage is Janice. She's not here, so let's reappoint her.
I'm sure she'd like that.
Yeah, she'd like that. Downtown TIF, I think, is Rick.
Yes, I will continue to serve if I may.
Is there any report that you want to share with us?
We haven't had a meeting since last year sometime.
Okay.
Yeah, I haven't heard anything.
We have a big new project to work on.
Yes, we do. Maybe there'll be one soon.
Okay. The next one I have is the Economic Development Committee, and at this point, the committee has basically completed about 34 recommendations, something like that. Just so everyone understands, the Economic Development Committee is charged with the responsibility of rewriting Chapter 6 of the Master Plan. And the Economic Development Committee is advisory only, controls no money, is not tasked with doing any investigations or any research. It's really making a making recommendations to the Planning Board, and the Planning Board will deal with those recommendations. And at this point, kind of the second half of our work is more or less at a very good point, and we are at the process of trying to develop the context and the lead-in data, so to speak. We may try to get an intern to help us. We'll see. But right now, there's not any meeting scheduled for the EDC until we have something that we can look at. So that's the latest. Do we have any other committees that I missed? Rick? Stratford Planning.
And I'll be glad to continue if Cynthia will have me again. And
I don't have anything to do with it.
Great. Thank you very much, Rick. We appreciate you serving on that.
Yeah, and he's on the executive committee, so.
Well, you're moving up.
Yes.
That and a nickel get you, you know what?
Should get a lot of projects in town now,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, sure.
Pull some weight over there.
Yeah, you have any earmarks,
right? Let me say this about that. Your brother Bobby and I don't agree with you.
Okay, any other committees? Okay, thank you very much. Next, I have the Lamprey River nomination to the state of New Hampshire. And Diane, could you bring us up to date on where that stands right now?
Yes, well, if you recall in our last planning board meeting, it was indicated the Conservation Commission had not completed their review, and it was the failing of the planning board that the board wanted to wait to see what their recommendation would be before taking any kind of official action, if you will, on the letter of support. And I understand that the Conservation Commission at its last meeting did come up with a recommendation, and we have a letter that has been drafted by the chairman, and I've made that available to all of the planning board members. And I see that Mr. Kiefhaber is here from the Conservation Commission. I know he's been sort of spearheading this effort. I didn't know if maybe he might want to address
certainly
the Conservation Commission's recommendation, or of course Ms. Sheldon could do the same.
Make your effort to come here worthwhile.
I did come. I haven't prepared anything. I am aware that you have the letter that was drafted by the Conservation Commission, and it's being forwarded to both the nominating committee and the Department of Environmental Services. If you have any questions regarding that, I'd be happy to answer them, or try to answer them as the case may be. But I really don't have anything per se to present.
I didn't mean to put you on the spot.
No,
I just wanted
fine.
To recognize your efforts.
Sure. Well, I figured I'd be here to answer questions if need be.
Yeah, this is I guess the only comment I'll make is that in the last meeting where we talked about this, there was a concern raised about the classification of rural versus community and community rural, and you've recommended that be changed. Is that right?
That's correct.
Yeah.
Okay. Our recommendation for nomination is contingent upon that change. We have been in contact with the nominating committee. They are very open to that suggestion. They've said they'll make that change.
Okay.
I received that same feedback from, I saw Dawn Jean at a meeting, and she had indicated that would be acceptable by the watershed committee that's working on the nomination. So I think that recommendation will be endorsed.
All right. Are there any other comments or questions? Eric?
Two things. One is, and I think we talked about this last time, if at any point we want to withdraw from this, what is the process? Or is
this
it?
Isn't, what is being asked of the town is a letter of support. It's not, the town is not being asked whether or not you want to participate in the program. So there really isn't a process for withdrawal that I'm aware of. I mean, basically, what is being asked is, as they go forward with their, and please jump in if you have more information than I, but as they go forward with their process, they are going to be making the nomination to the Commissioner of DES. And as part of that nomination process, they need, they are providing letters from communities showing their interest in this concept. There's no legal requirement that the towns have to approve to do this. So this process that we've been going through is to get letters of support from the Planning Board, Conservation Commission. I think they've also
There was one town that chose not to be a part of it a while back, right? And specifically, wasn't there?
You don't choose or not choose, because anyone can nominate a river or water body for designation. And it's, the nomination goes through DES and is made by the commissioner to the state legislature. So it's whether or not the rivers become included or the water bodies under statute that the law applies relative to designated protection of the designated rivers and management. So it's not whether or not a town picks or chooses. However, under the RSA, in order to, as part of the application to apply for the designated river status, the whoever's doing that application, whether it's an individual or a group, or in this case, you know, the Watershed Association, that they are required to solicit, to hold public meetings and solicit comments. So it's not whether or not a town is giving a letter of support or non-support, it's they're soliciting the comments. So we have the ability to comment on the application. Our comments could be, these are our concerns, or these are the reasons that we would hope that, you know, that these waters would be included. That's under the RSA. It's not whether or not they have to go and get
writing a letter of support.
Those comments are considered by the commissioner in coming forward with his recommendation to the legislature as to whether or not the Lamprey River is designated into the program or not.
Right, but what Val just said is different than what I thought we've talked about. We've always indicated a letter of support, which is not what Val said.
That's correct. Under the RSA, they're soliciting comments from the public, commissions and boards. That's under the RSA.
Right, okay.
The way that they're choosing to go about it, and I would too if I was, you know, on the committee, is to obtain letters of support.
As opposed to just comments. Yeah.
Okay. Because that's going to provide a better application to go before the commissioner. And that is another, you know, our letter also has, you know, contingencies and concerns from the commission. And the other thing that's added to this letter, and Drew touched upon, that you don't see, is that a copy of this is also going to DES. Because if this was a letter of all of non-support, the committee who's making the nomination could simply choose not to provide it to DES. They're the ones that are making the application. And so that's why we are also sending a copy to DES.
It doesn't just get us represent. This gets us representation on the.
I think the key is if we're designated,
committee.
If the Lamprey River and Newmarket or the Piscassic, or, you know, or both,
right.
if it goes into effect, the law is passed, we by statute have a seat at the board, because if your water bodies within your town are designated, then you are on that advisory committee. You have seats on that advisory committee. Under the statute.
Right. Okay. Whether it was supported or not.
Right.
Right, but I think one of the people that were here earlier said that there's never been an area designated where the town has not supported it. Right, wasn't there one town, Northwater, Nottingham, or somebody said no to it, and they didn't, that stretch of river, they did not. Is that correct?
Cynthia?
Cynthia
has some.
We worked on the Isinglass River nomination.
Please, could you step up? Thank you. Don't go far away.
We worked, Stafford Regional Planning assisted on two nomination processes, and we're working on the Oyster River right now. And so, what, to give an example, when the Cochico went through 2 years ago, there was a community that City Council, Rochester, voted very closely not to support the nomination, and they gave reasons in their letter, you know, for and why they had concerns and why they supported, because there was a very close vote of the City Council. And that letter got sent in. It was included in the nomination documents by the Cochico Watershed Coalition, and it, a direct letter, like Val said, went directly to DES. And then because we were assisting the Watershed Coalition with their responses and preparations of the documents, we received a letter from the commissioner and from the New Hampshire Rivers Management Council when they had their hearings, addressing all of the issues that any community or any member of the public had, including that City Council. And we had to address all of those issues and do research and discuss why, you know, this you know, what is the exact state and status of this concern. The one in Rochester had to do with hydropower, you know, generation of hydropower. So they take all of the issues and comments that come forward very carefully, and anything where there's a question, they ask to have a response generated for that addresses it. And normally we have to go in and do the science behind it to pull out the facts for them.
And can I ask a question?
Yes, sir.
What was the result of the Rochester? Rochester City Council did not support it. Was it nominated? Was it?
It's nominated, and they have members on the. So it, just like Val said, there was a public hearing,
yep,
that's held by the New Hampshire Rivers Management Council. They make a recommendation to the DES commissioner, and then he comes out in the fall with a response recommending or not. If he recommends, then they find a legislator to sponsor the bill. And then it goes forward, and there's public hearings at the Senate and the House, and the public has the opportunity to comment, to come to the hearings and send letters and communicate,
right,
whatever.
But I guess I guess I miss the whole point of this is it doesn't matter what we say. Is what,
no,
I thought,
well,
we, I thought when they first came, yeah, we were asked
it's not
to support,
whether or not,
and you know, basically the local input was the overriding factor. But apparently that's not the case. It doesn't. I mean, apparently Rochester, the City Council of Rochester said no, and they did it anyways.
It's a very close vote. It was like 5-4.
Well, it doesn't matter. It's
right.
You vote either for or against.
It's
so
not home rule, if that's what you're saying.
Yeah, it's not. That's
correct.
Kind of what I'm saying. So,
but the representatives on the local advisory LAC committee now are representative of the views of Rochester. So when they're doing their work of the local advisory committee, they include the diversity of the views in Rochester. So that is still reflected in going forward in how they do their work.
Yeah, but they were fine with the diversity of the views as long as they supported them. Where the city did not support the nomination, they just ignored that and went through with the process anyways.
But the concerns that they had, they nominated people to the committee that still reflect those concerns and are sort of the watchdogs on the LAC for that view and opinion and perspective of the city and citizens.
No, I understand that, and I appreciate,
okay,
that, but the views of the people of the City Council that said we don't want to be part of this were ignored.
They were taken into consideration,
yeah, taken
when the commissioner made his recommendation to the legislature on whether or not the river and the nomination,
yeah,
should go,
yeah,
forward or not.
Yeah.
They were taken into consideration, but there's nothing in the state law that says each and every community has to buy into this.
No, and that's what I guess I'm understanding tonight, was I thought when it was first explained to us it was a home rule, basically a home rule situation, but that's not the case.
So the Conservation Commission could support it with these provisos. We could write a letter of support. The town council could write a letter of support.
And they could not be nominated.
Right, exactly. And vice versa. We could all oppose it, and then we'd go ahead and nominate anyone.
Right. I guess the only issue I have with it is that I think we're impacting a lot of property owners in town, and we're giving, we're not giving authority, but there's a advisory commission that right now was said to be advisory.
Let me clarify that for Newmarket. If you're listed as a designated river, then it makes you subject to the State Shoreland Protection Act. Our Newmarket water bodies, the Piscassic River and the Lamprey River, which is what they're proposing in the nomination, are already subject to the Shoreland Protection Act. The impact it will have on property owners in Newmarket is that any application, any DES application that is required to be submitted to the town clerk's office.
Right, absolutely.
Are first required to send a certified a copy of the application certified to the advisory committee.
Right.
And then they need to provide a copy or proof of that mailing with their application to DES. So
right.
That's the additional burden on the applicant.
Right.
Any DES application that requires it to go to the
clerks. No.
And then the advisory committee, obviously, just like the Conservation Commission with wetlands permits, has the ability to comment on that application.
Right, as an in an advisory capacity.
Just like the Conservation
right.
Commission.
Right.
Just in an advisory capacity.
Right. Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
Okay.
Yep.
We're good?
I'm good.
Diane.
Yeah, I just wanted to mention that we did receive an email from George Willen, dated May 14th, and just to paraphrase this for the public, he obviously is not at that meeting tonight, and it was his understanding that the board will be voting on whether to support the advisory commission's nomination. And from his comments at previous meetings, he realizes that the board supports the formation of the nomination, supports the nomination of the Lamprey River into this program. He said that he doesn't really see any downside in this, and there's a number of advantages. Specifically, the town would have a seat at the table, so to speak, and would be able to comment on activities that are planned upstream from the town. And he understands that the Conservation Commission's comments are already part of the legislative process, and the commission's comments wouldn't result in, when he says commissions, he's referring to the advisory committees, I believe, that it would not result in regulatory delays. And since he sees no disadvantage to the town, he was hoping that his thoughts would be read into the record and that would be considered by the board as part of our deliberations this evening.
Thank you. Anything else? Any other comments, discussions, questions? So I guess what we have the Conservation Commission. Is that a final draft or?
This was voted to be signed by the chair and sent to the nominating committee with a copy to DES.
Okay. All right. So another question is, does the planning board want to support this? And if so, in what format or fashion should we consider the comments of the Conservation Commission in our support letter, if that's the will of the board? Yes, sir.
Again, just as a clarification, it doesn't need to be a letter of support.
Right.
It's comments. Right.
Okay.
But the Conservation Commission chose to support it.
Conservation Commission chose to issue a conditional support.
Yes.
Yes.
Okay.
That's good.
Thank you.
You know, and the commission is, the commission is taking a position based upon what the commission's, you know, mission is and what their requirements are under the statute, which is protection of water quality. And that's what the Designated Rivers Act, you know, mission in, you know, is.
Right, but this doesn't necessarily do that. Necessarily, because it doesn't create any new laws, no new...
It doesn't create any new laws applicable to Newmarket relative to the Shoreland Protection Act. There are specific water quality levels that are required to be obtained within those designated rivers.
Which are currently now. It doesn't change anything.
I don't think it changes anything for Newmarket.
I don't think it changes anything for anybody. There's no new federal or state law or requirement that this...
It's just a process. It's just a process.
Right.
Where these things can be reviewed on a watershed basis and...
Right, it doesn't change any of the current regulations. It just gives you another, gives you a designation, but it also gives you a reviewing, another reviewing board to look at things and comment, is what it does.
To provide a different perspective.
It doesn't create any new, more stringent standards or anything.
That's correct.
Right, okay.
If I may?
Yes.
It is likely to create, within Newmarket, our rivers are already covered by the Comprehensive Shoreland Protection Act. That is not necessarily true of the Lamprey River mainstream, further upstream, and some of the major tributaries further upstream. So somewhere between likely and it will have an additional regulatory burden on upstream towns, residents, et cetera.
However, Newmarket being at the end of the river.
We're at the receiving end.
We stand to benefit.
Right. Our water quality is directly affected by what goes on upstream of us.
I thought the Shoreland
Protection... There's better water quality because of enhanced enforcement at the upper reaches of the watershed, then that's going to benefit the town of Newmarket.
But I thought the Shoreland Protection came into effect for any Class 4 or higher river. Yes?
Yes.
So this changes that?
It changes.
Not in town, somewhere else.
The Comprehensive Shoreland...
Right, or higher.
Relates to any river that's Class 4, Tier 4, Class 4.
Right.
And then any river nominated or legislated through the New Hampshire's River Management and Protection Program. So some of those tributaries and part of the Lamprey upstream may be Tier 3, and so therefore, right now, they're not subject to the Comprehensive Shoreland Protection. And that's where it's a benefit to Newmarket to have that additional water quality regulation in place upstream from Newmarket.
Okay, so it impacts areas outside of Newmarket, not in Newmarket. Okay, thank you.
And that's what you're understanding?
Yeah, correct. That is correct.
Okay.
I know Nottingham had it.
Okay. So what is the will of the board? Do we want to comment to the appropriate parties as the Conservation Commission has done? And I very personally, I like the tenor and the recommendations of the Conservation Commission letter. We can ask, I have a question though. What is the timing on this? When does the comment letters, support letters, or whatever we might write, when do they have to be in?
Okay. June 1st.
June 1st, isn't it? That the application needs to be in by June 1st.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I believe the application needs to be in by June 1st, and I think the nominating committee was looking for approximately a week prior to that. But don't quote me on that.
Eric?
Can I make a suggestion that we either work with the Conservation Commission and draft a joint letter, or, you know, basically get your signature on the same letter with the appropriate edits, or write a letter mirroring this?
Would that work?
Have you already sent the letter?
not sure. Bruce was going to...
Oh, because Bruce was still the chair.
Oh, maybe gone already?
It's...
I'm sorry.
It's entirely possible, and I would say likely, that the Conservation Commission letter is in the mail.
Okay.
You know, all it required was a signature and a stamp.
And he signed it that evening.
Can't we just paraphrase their letter and...
If that's the will of the board, if that's...
I'm fine with that.
Or just a one-sentence letter saying we support the letter of the Conservation Commission.
We could do that. What would you like to see? Do I have a motion here, or...
Make a motion that we draft a short, concise letter supporting the letter drafted by the Conservation Commission for signature by the chairman.
All right. Is there a second?
Second.
All right. It's moved and seconded. Any further discussion?
I think that there would be a conditional letter of support conditioned on the reclassification of the rivers as mentioned by the Conservation. That was the only real reservation, wasn't it?
That was correct.
Yeah. All right. All right. Any further discussion? Seeing none, I'll call for a vote. All those in favor of the motion, please indicate by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? All right. I'll ask Diane to draft up something, and with your agreement, I'll go ahead and sign it and send it off, and it will paraphrase in the Conservation Commission letter. All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Peter reminded me that the CIP committee, to which he's graciously once again volunteered, needs an alternate. So do we have someone who would
I'll volunteer if you'd like to have me back again with my working chair.
There you got it. Okay, thank you, Rick. You're going to be a busy guy. Okay. Next, again, under this, we have an update. And I asked Diane to pull this together for us.
Oh.
First, a very brief update from Mr. Landry.
Yes.
On the 3 North Main project.
Yes. We contacted Mr. Landry to ask for an update on the proposed shopping center at 34 North Main Street, and I received an email back, and I'll read it to you. Diane, we've had some tough issues to overcome. There are some wetlands out back, and we have had to redesign the project a little to have as minimal of an impact as possible. This has caused a delay in finalizing some lease deals, so we are back to that now. We are still working hard. So that, to me, says it's still in the works,
still
but
in
they're
the works. Okay.
Trying to overcome some development obstacles.
Great. Thank you. We're going to talk again in a second about impact fees, but could you give us a brief update of Mr. Chinberg and what's happening there?
Yes.
We gave him a six-month extension, but he does have some timelines. He has to meet this month.
That's correct. If you recall, one of the conditions of the planning board approval back in October was that certain work would be completed by May 31st, 2010 in order to for the town to move forward with the paving of Main Street as part of the Main Street reconstruction project. And I did have a meeting with Mr. Chinberg and the engineer of Underwood Engineers, as well as the contractor who's working with the town on completing the paving work, Severino Contractors. And at this point, Mr. Chinberg will be hiring them, Severino, to do the work that's proposed within the public right-of-way. And we received a cost estimate from their engineer, and our engineer is reviewing that right now, which will become the basis, if you will, for the performance bond that's required. It's a 50% performance bond required for work within the town's right-of-way, which was another one of the conditions of approval of the planning board. Subsequent to that, I've been working on the developer's agreement, and...
Why don't we go right into that?
Yeah, and there's a couple of issues that are still outstanding on that. We're working with the attorneys, our engineer, and also Mr. Chinberg to
come up with some reasonable compromises relating to that. And one of the issues that came up pertained to impact fees. And in going through the records, I noted that we did not, when we did our formal approval of the project, the conditional approval, we did not officially or make a motion to levy, if you will, the impact fees for the project as we have done in other other projects in the past. So I have put together this memo on the impact fees associated with the mill project. And there are some questions that have come up in my mind, and I've gone through and come up with a methodology to address some of those issues, and I wanted to review that with the board.
Okay, please do.
Okay. As you know, there are two different types of impact fees here in Newmarket. There's a residential impact fee, which addresses impacts on public schools, recreation facilities, wastewater, and water. And then there's the non-residential impact fee, which is based on the commercial uses that are anticipated. And the way our system is set up, there's only, for non-residential uses, there's only a fee charged for wastewater impacts and for water impacts. And in my memo, giving you a little bit of background, the process for coming up with the residential impact fee is very straightforward because it's a set amount based on a per unit charge. And however, for determining the fees for non-residential uses, because it only applies to water and wastewater, it's less straightforward and it's based on projected water flows. And there are a number of methodologies that are used by engineers in determining what the anticipated flow is for water and wastewater purposes. And unfortunately, there isn't a ready-made gallon per day requirement as there is for the residential use. And the projected water flows can be dependent upon the number of the nature of the use, the number of employees, and the square footage. And as part of our special use permit application for the mills, we asked the applicant's engineer to give us an estimate of wastewater and water flows. And it was based on the square footage of 36,300 square feet of space that would be developed under that category. And the figure they came up with was 5,445 gallons per day. And that's...
Do we have copies of this?
You should. It should be right in front of you. No?
Nope.
Well, my apologies.
I grabbed one off the... There were some on that front table. I grabbed one off of there earlier.
I'm sorry, Diane. Oh,
thank you.
I apologize.
No, thank you.
Thank you.
I have an extra here too. Does everyone have one now?
Mm-hmm.
I'm sorry. I asked that one be put at each place, and my apologies that you didn't get it. Okay, so if you turn to Exhibit A, which is the third sheet in, these are the figures that were provided to us by Mr. Chimberg's engineer. Based on the number of units and the type of units that were proposed for the residential piece, and also based on what the projected square footage was for non-residential use. And they calculated the flow data based on standards that are provided by the New Hampshire Department of Environmental Services. They're used for, they're called unit design flow figures, and they're used for actually septic system designs. And Eric, I know you do this in the engineering world, so if you have some other clarifications and you want to jump in, please do.
No, I read it before the meeting, actually, and I agree with the methodology.
Okay.
I mean, it's a pretty standard way of determining flows.
Okay. So under that, what we didn't have was a handle on what the existing flows were, and I was able to get some data from the Water and Sewer Department to identify historically have been the water usages in the mills. And over the course of a five-year period, we were able to come up with an average annual of a little bit over 1 million gallons per day. And if you divide that by 365 days, now that's per year. And if you divide that by 365 days per year, you get a comparable figure that can be compared with the figures that Mr. Chinberg's engineer had derived. And if you subtract that from their projection, the additional water demand is 2,594 gallons per day. And with this data, I was able to plug in the impact fee based on our fee schedule, and I was able to come up with the total impact fee of $302,394. And if you turn to the spreadsheet, that's what the second page in, you'll see how that is calculated out for the project. So what I would like to have the board do is make a motion to assess the impact fees for the project in accordance with the spreadsheet and the data and the research we've done. We're suggesting that it be done on the basis of an amount not to exceed. So if there's other information that becomes available that shows that our projections were lower than what was anticipated, that we would provide that opportunity for the applicant to refine the data and be assessed a lower fee in accordance with it. And I just want to mention that this process that's outlined here was what was recommended by Bruce Mabry, who was the consultant who worked on the impact fee ordinance back in 2000. And I'm happy to make copies of that available to any board member that would like to peruse it and get a sense of how these fees were derived and what the assumptions were and the basis for them.
Has Mr. Chinberg seen this data?
Yes, he has. And he is. He was concerned that a use might come in which would exceed this 302,000 gallon, $302,000 amount. And so he asked if we could couch this in terms of that the impact fees for the project would not exceed that dollar amount. And that's why the recommendation is presented as it is. And I thought that was a reasonable approach. I think is going forward as part of this project, he needs to have a front end of what his, set costs are going to be, so that he can make sure that his financing package is in sync with what the actual cost.
And you're comfortable with all the data you've been able to hold together?
Yeah. I know.
Val.
Prior to the issuance of the occupancy permit for the existing commercial use, what impact fee was paid?
He hasn't paid anything yet. But he should be.
And then the second question is, and it came up a few times, where are we relative to the authority to assess impact fees under our current ordinance?
We have an ordinance that's in effect.
Is it not expired?
The ordinance does not expire. It is recommended that we review it and update it every 5 years. That doesn't mean that it's expired. It has to be renewed, if you will, every 5 years.
What's the status right now? Is it still in effect? Do we need to renew it?
As far as I'm concerned, it's in effect.
But it's been longer than 5 years
since
it was initially. Right. So it's time to be revisited.
But
right.
What's who does it? What's the process? Is it the planning board?
The planning board would do that, and we would have to hire consultants to do it because there's a lot of, as you can see, there's a lot of data that needs to be gathered and analyzed to be able to come up with the fees and to be able to come up with the rationale, if you will, and the legal basis for the impact.
Seems to me, Val, we spoke about this two or three meetings ago about about rewriting this.
Yep.
Or revisiting it is what I should say.
Yeah, because under the ordinance, being that it was required to be reviewed every 5 years,
doesn't mean it's void because it hasn't been, though.
That was just the question that was put forward that was going to be followed up on.
And it will be. We've been working on shoreland protection and floodplains.
Are there
other priorities of the board at this?
are there funds available to, you say you have to hire a consultant, which I can understand. Are there funds available to do that?
We have funding in our consulting budget in the amount of $10,000, and part of those funds could be used for that purpose.
How difficult a task is this to do?
Well, we'd have to put out an RFP and hire a consultant and...
No, I mean, is it a week's work or is it a month's work? Do you have a feel for that?
I would say it's probably a 3 to 6 month process.
Because isn't the basis of it to update the impact fees relative to the actual costs, the actual impacts for water, sewer?
Right.
Yes.
Recreation, school?
Yep.
Yes.
But I would say 3 to 6 months from start to finish, given how long it takes to get things done, realistically.
Well, it seems like if it's a requirement or a strong recommendation that be done every 5 years and we haven't done it, seems that we should do it.
That's right. I'm not disagreeing. I'm just trying to inject some realism as to what's involved in doing it.
I understand. That's why I was asking.
It's not a simple task, and it has to be done meticulously or else it can be subject to challenge.
Well, then it begs the question, is $10,000 enough?
Well, I have to get a proposal from some consultants to see what it would cost.
I would guess it's probably not.
That's my feeling.
It's a lot of going through a lot of records and research and actually breaking out the costs. You know, it's a lot of running around.
Number crunching.
Yep.
Is that would it be feasible for you to come back to us at the next planning board meeting
in June?
In June,
sure.
With some proposals or recommendations or something we can take some action on to get this moving forward?
I can get a preliminary proposal. If we were to do an RFP, and we would have to get people, you know, at least 3 to 4 weeks to respond to the RFP, and, you know, that's a much longer process.
All right, why don't we do that? See if you can come back with something on in June.
Right, I just want to make sure it's understood that our ordinance is not null and void because we haven't accomplished that task.
I understand.
It just makes it somewhat suspect if somebody challenges it.
Right. Then, but we don't have to, with regard to Mr. Chinberg and the mills, you're looking for a recommendation or an approval tonight of not to exceed $302,000.
So we can include that figure in the developer's agreement. And Mr.
Okay.
Chinberg has agreed in concept to that proposal.
Even though it's done under the ordinance that we just now decided is at least 5 years old?
Yes.
Okay. All right. Eric?
I have a comment on the spreadsheet. If everybody would turn to the last page, please. First of all, Diane, I think you did a good job on it. I mean, it's a lot of number crunching, and I agree with the methodology. The one issue I have with it is item one on the last page, which says historic water usage, Newmarket Mills. That's not the last 5 years. That's a 5-year period. So I'd rather see 2008 and 2009
I'll
included.
Tell you why. The mills
because it was
actually,
zero.
The mills actually closed. I mean, the business left September 2008. We did not have full year data for 2008, so I took the last 5 years for which we had full data available.
Right, but is that the way the impact thing is written? I mean, if that mill sat vacant for 5 years and there was no water usage, the last 5 years would be zero, and you'd be responsible for the increase.
All it said, there's really no guidance provided in the for existing uses. It's basically you're providing, you can't charge more than the additional demand for service associated with the new use. And if you look at the first,
that was confusing to me too.
Right. I mean, I think
it's in our ordinance.
Right.
It's a conversion. The conversion of an existing use is subject to impact fees to the extent that it creates an increased demand for public capital facilities.
So you don't go back to zero and start over?
You don't go back to zero. You say, okay, well, when the mills were operating, and, you know, the data that's on page five, whatever, the last page, you know, shows what the usage was, so that, you know, in effect, the developer is entitled to a credit for that, because his development is providing an increment of demand on the system, and that's all he's legally, he's responsible for paying the impact fee on, not for all the uses.
Right, but,
and that's right in our ordinance.
And if that's the case, then I just then have an issue with the language that it's not the previous five-year period.
But it doesn't say the previous five-year period is a reasonable time frame that I came up with.
You were just trying to set a...
I was just trying to set some...
And that's fine.
That's what I had data available for.
One at a time.
That's fine. I'm just saying I don't disagree with that, but that's not the previous five-year period.
What I think you wanted to say is the latest five-year period with full annual...
Is that the right answer?
With full data available.
Full annual data.
Exactly.
Maybe you can change that worded.
Right.
You're just trying to come up with a base.
I'm trying to explain in the future to anyone who wants to know how we came up with those figures, that this is how we came up with them. And we felt comfortable with this methodology.
I think you just need a note of explanation.
Right. Okay.
Yeah. Okay. So let me ask this then.
Go ahead.
Does anyone on the board have a problem with approving a motion that the impact fees on the mills will not exceed $302,000 indicated in the analysis by Diane?
I have a question, and maybe it's because it precedes my time in town, but if it's not necessarily the last 5 years, even of full data that are required, but if there's perhaps a more representative, more recent five-year period, the impression I had was that the mills were only in partial use.
That's all I have data for.
Well,
but if at full use, at full capacity, say from 1998 to 2003, there was even more water being used than this, then maybe that's a more accurate reflection. I don't know.
But I think, as I understand it, so Diane, what you're trying to do is determine, okay, this was a reasonable average usage when, in the most recent years that things were operating, and the town was already paying for that. Here's the additional impact on the water and sewer for the increase in usage,
right,
because of the conversion of, whether or not it's just some space or all the space, it's just the conversion of that property.
I'm just saying that from 98 to 2003, there were even more water being used in this, then the impact would even be less than what's reflected here. And so if anything, I guess that supports the idea that we might approve not to go above that $300,000 figure.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Peter.
The only concern I have is if there was some water-intensive use brought in there, whether it's a brew pub or something else of that nature, and it skyrockets the water use, and I, you know, I don't know how you got against it other than to specifically say that.
Other than by saying that we're not going to establish a figure at this stage for the commercial piece, we're going to wait until we know specifically who the tenants are and what type of use is going to be. And that's what this methodology is suggesting that we do, is when the building permit application comes in, you'll have a clearer sense of who the tenant's going to be. And at that point, that data can be established.
Mm-hmm.
And you can get a handle on what the impact would be based on that use.
Eric.
I guess I have a question. I have an issue with approving a not-to-exceed number. And the only reason I have that is this probably is going to be a multi-year project. So I guess the question I have is, at what point in time are the impact fees actually, at what point in time are you actually liable for them? And the reason I'm asking that is that, you know, in the next 5 years or 10 years, this town is going to be spending a ton of money on a new sewer treatment plant, new water improvements, and the impact fee rates may go up substantially due to those improvements. And I'd hate to give him an open, I'd hate to give anybody an open-ended, you know, not to exceed and have the project sit, you know, not that it's economically good for him to sit for 5 years and then all of a sudden start building it, and the impact fees are double what these are, what we've committed to these. So at what point, according to our regulations, at what point is it?
According to our regulations, it's at the time that the occupancy permit is issued. At the time the building permit is issued, the applicant is supposed to provide the data to determine
then,
what that would be.
Okay.
But at the time of issuance of the occupancy permit, that's when the developer has to pay them.
If our numbers get updated in the next year and they go up significantly, we're not able to recover any of that. So I guess I would rather just approve the number. Say at this point in time, it looks like the impact fees are $302,000, but you know, whatever they are when you get your occupancy permits are what you're going to pay, up or down.
Right.
I'm comfortable with that.
Eric brings a really good point to the table, and we should use all of the Bennett Way, all the Cheney approvals as an example of that, when all of the water and sewer fees were prepaid years ago. And those rates substantially changed when the buildings were constructed, by the time those buildings were constructed. And the town will still be subsidizing that because there's still more buildings to be constructed.
Right.
So that just so that history doesn't repeat itself, I think it would be appropriate to use Diane's calculations and justifications to establish an impact fee for current occupancy permits. Using the commercial space that was just open as a good example, the impact fee should have been assessed under the regulations prior to that occupancy permit being issued. So there needs to be some basis in order to at least establish an impact fee for that portion.
So you're saying the impact fees applicable at the time of the CO?
That's what Diane was just mentioning.
Right.
Yep. This one is paid. This is just putting him on notice on what our estimates are at this time, given the data we have.
But by that explanation, it's impossible to guarantee him a ceiling of $302,000.
Well, that's what he'd like us to do. I'm
well,
sure.
I can understand
like
why.
Right, absolutely.
But if you, one of the buildings may be, I mean, it's feasible that it's, you know, it's because we've seen it in town, that they're grandfathered for 10, 20 years and it's not constructed.
Right.
That's
why I prefer not to give and not to exceed. I have no problem voting tonight to assess impact fees of $302,000, but not with a ceiling. And they go up or down, whatever, and he has to pay the appropriate amount at the time.
Okay.
He has the right to come before this board at any point and request a waiver of fees if he feels that it's warranted. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, that can still happen, even though it's a dollar amount that's written into the developer's agreement. Things do change.
And the basis for that would be
whatever information that he can come forward.
It's all warehouse and there's no water usage and blah, blah, blah.
We've waived it on different projects, you know, because it might have, you know, we've waived school impact fees because the units were applicable more to to university students and not children going to the school. We've waived several times impact fees before this board.
Right.
Okay.
Okay.
Rick?
Just a question. The fee per gallon, is that based on 2009, 2010 fees?
That's the fee that's in effect currently.
Based
on the work that was done by Bruce Mabry, and as Val pointed out,
it's not a compilation
over 5 years ago.
2005, 2007.
It's what is approved under the ordinance at that time, or what the impact fee fees are. For that period of the ordinance, and then when we update it, the fees and impact fees may change.
And it will be applicable to the fees that are
It may be that instead of having these, you know, the differences between two unit structures, multifamily, blah blah blah, it may be that it's a per bedroom fee. As simple as that.
Okay.
Or square footage fee. Or.
All right. Do I hear a motion on this?
I'll make a motion to. That We assess impact fees at the current time of $302,394 for the Newmarket Mills LLC redevelopment of tax map U2, lots 365, 366, 367 in the M1 zone.
Val?
Is the intent to have an amendment to, but that the actual amount would be the impact fee at the time of occupancy permit?
Yes. Yes.
I don't know how you want to state that, but.
You want to try
but that's, and that's what your intent.
Well, I think that's, the way I understand it, that's a given, that that's the impact fee you pay. So I don't think, I didn't know whether we need to say that.
I think your motion, though, was to just set the impact fee at this number.
Right.
Right, today, that is the impact fee, right?
On the assumptions that we have.
Right.
But I think we have to be clear, or we might want to add an amendment to Eric's motion if he doesn't choose to change it himself, and that is that there be at this present time that be established no ceiling, because they would have to be assessed at the time of the buildup.
Right, and the actual impact fees paid are those impact fees due at the time of occupancy.
Does that work?
Yeah.
You got all that down?
That's what he said.
That was the intention. That was the intention.
Impact fee is due at the time.
That's the only reason I asked.
That's a good point to make sure we're clear.
Can you change it to say for actual fees and usage at the time of completion, something like that? Would that help?
I think this.
No, I think this
probably works.
Specific act, which the issuance of the occupancy permit.
All right. We have a motion. Is there a second?
Second.
All right. Any further discussion? Seeing none, I'll call for a vote. All those in favor of the motion indicate by saying aye.
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 Opposed? Abstentions? Okay. Then that's the number that goes in the.
The number that goes into the development agreement.
Right. And but the final number is yet to be determined.
Well, it's based on what the situation is when he comes in for his certificate of occupancy.
Let's move forward, though, with trying to rewrite this ordinance. Now, are there any other issues with the draft developers agreement that we need to deal with?
No, not at this point.
If you've looked at this development, this is amazing.
I haven't seen it.
Diane's done a lot of hard work on this, I know that. And it's been through the town, our legal counsel?
Legal counsel has reviewed it, and the town engineer has reviewed it as well.
And Eric's reviewed it.
And Eric has reviewed it.
Okay.
And
so Eric doesn't have any more other
There are a couple
concerns.
Of other concerns that Eric had, and I'm working on getting those sorted out. There are some requirements regarding surveys for blasting that need to be done, that there's a survey done of properties within 1,000 feet. And he had some concerns about, you know, feeling that that was an onerous requirement. I've sent a letter to our fire chief to find out what his take is on that. I don't know if that's something the planning board would like to weigh in on.
Where did the 1,000 feet come from? That would be my only comment.
This was draft language that was included in a previous development agreement that was done for the Selectwood property.
Okay. I mean, that's pretty, it's pretty standard to have pre-blast surveys done. I've been involved in several projects that have had them in cities. You have them, and, or pre-digging surveys if you're digging deep holes or something like that. The 1,000 feet seems kind of arbitrary. It's usually based on the type of geology report on the type of soil or the type of rock. So, you know, in this case, the right number might be, you know, 500 or something. That's why I asked where the 1,000 came from.
There's no RSA on it or anything like that?
No.
Well, that's why I asked Rick Malosky if there was some RSA or some standard.
And what that involves is companies that around that just, they basically, they hire people that they go in and they video every wall of every building, foundations, interior walls, you know, and they have a video record of it so that if somebody complains that the blasting cracked their walls, they have a record that, okay, it wasn't cracked before anyways, so.
Should it be based on the Bryant Rock approval?
Well, that's what was included in that developer's agreement. That's where I got the language from.
He was involved with Bryant
Rock. So it's just been,
He was involved with Bryant Rock. Bryant Rock.
Right. So I don't know if at the time the planning board did some research and came up with that standard and felt it was...
I don't imagine they'll be doing any blasting, though, will they?
Depends on what...
I don't know.
I asked Diane that. I don't know what's underneath the Eagle Building, you know. Right. Wants to put a...
This courtyard area?
Courtyard in there.
Yeah. But if it's, generally now, if they're small areas, they don't blast them, they hole ram them out. You know, a hammer on an end of a machine.
Jackhammer.
Big jackhammer, put them on ends of excavators, you know, which, but...
I don't know.
My comment would be let him offer, let him, if he wants to say it's 500 feet, if he has an engineer or something that can justify for the type of rock around here that it's not necessary for more than 500 feet or something like that, that would be considered, but that does sound arbitrary, the 1,000 feet.
And the other issue is just the performance bond. We need to have the engineer review it to make sure the figures are reasonable. What we want to make sure is, if you recall the way the condition was worded, the performance bond covers off-site improvements. So we need to have a clear understanding of what's in the off-site category versus what's in the, you know, on-site category. And the engineer is grappling with that. I think he's going to be meeting with Chimberg's engineer to, you know, mark up a plan so it's clearly understood, so that he can advise us whether the dollar amount is...
Who's our engineer on that?
His engineer is Jeff...
He is Jeff Clifford from Altus.
Right.
Who's ours? Is it VHB?
Is Phil McDonald from Underwood Engineers.
Okay.
And the initial cost estimate came in about $35,000 for the...
Offsite?
Offsite improvements. And that's the bump outs and the curbing, mm-hmm. and so it wasn't a huge amount. But and then there's still the question of the public service removal of the lines that needs to be figured into that equation.
Okay. Did he have any reaction to the pedestrian bridge success?
Other than he was thrilled with the word and the news. Yeah.
Yeah. It's gotta do it. So okay.
Surprised.
Yeah.
As we all were.
Oh, I was confident.
Yeah, I knew.
Higher source. Any other old business or new business?
Well, I think we should have on the record, you know, special thanks to Diane and everyone that worked on. Yeah,
Diane worked incredibly hard at that, and she did a great job in the presentation. It was terrific.
I mean, this is huge.
It's
going to
be a town symbol, branding, and everything moving forward for a long time.
Yep.
And take the push of the sailboat in the mill.
Yeah.
Well, Janice is not here to.
Motion to adjourn.
There it is. Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you very much.